Hey, Janik. You hungry?
I could go for some pizza.
Pizza? You only have like a 5-minute break.
Pizza.
All right, you know what? I know a solution.
Guys, Jordy here for CineCamp.net and welcome to Copycat Friday. I guess it's pretty obvious what we'll be recreating today. The intro that you saw was entirely made inside Premiere Pro. And you might think, isn't it easier in After Effects? Yes, correct. But where's the fun? Creating such visual effects in Premiere actually helps you to understand more advanced techniques better, so that you can take that with you on future projects. Now Rocketstock is sponsoring today's video, and we'll be using a smoke effect from their video pack Vapor by the end of the video. Now they made it very easy to add smoke effects in post-production. Definitely make sure to visit the first link in the description below to check it out. But for now, let's dive straight into the tutorial, as there's a lot that we need to cover. First up is the setup. Film yourself running quickly away from a tripod. Then hold that shot for a while so that you also have an empty space. We're going to need both. In Premiere Pro, you then want to place the shot where you take off on track number 3, and the empty shot on track number 1. Then determine where your subject needs to go super fast, and here you want to add a cut. Then right-click on that piece that you've cut off and select speed/duration. Set the speed to something around 1100%. We'll also decrease the opacity of this clip, and you can do so by pulling down this keyframe line right here. Pull it to something around 60%. Since the flash is running so fast, we have to add some motion blur to it. From your effects library, search for the directional blur. Drag this to your speeded up clip, and from its settings in the effects controls, you want to set the direction to 90 degrees and the blur length to around 35. And this should already make your subject lift off super fast. This was the first part. Now let's see how we can make some thunder and flashes. Duplicate the empty background you have on track 1 to track number 2. You can do this by simply holding down your Alt key and dragging the clip to your desired position. Add a cut on the same position as your first cut on the subject clip, and that cut will be the aftershock effect. Now you can make it as long as you want, but we took something about 2 seconds. Then head over to the effects library and search for Wave Warp. Drag that to the clip and navigate to the effect controls to locate the properties of the wave warp effect. Set the wave height to 2, wave width to 109, and the direction to 200 degrees. Now we're going to make an animation for the direction. In the beginning of the clip, enable the animation, which will create a keyframe for the 200 degree value. Then move to the end of the clip and change the directional value to 220. For a smoother animation, you might want to right-click on the first keyframe and select Ease Out. For the last keyframe, do the same thing, but here select Ease In. And this way the animation will start and end smooth. We're even going to expand the property so that we can see the animation curve. Pull the lever from the last keyframe to the left, which will make sure that the animation starts fast and slowly fades out to its final position. Now this aftershock effect only applies to the area around your subject, so from the opacity property, click on the circle mask tool. Enlarge the area around your subject and perhaps a bit of its path. Then in the settings, increase the feather a little bit. Now this aftershock also has to fade out, so apply a cross dissolve on the end of the clip. And if everything went well, your aftershock should look something like this. Now let's get into the lighting effects. From the New Item button in your project panel, Click to create a new transparent video layer. Drag it to track number 5 and trim it so that it overlays before the flash takes off. Our clip is about 12 frames long. Then head over to your effects library and search for lightning. Drag that effect to the transparent video. And this is going to be the charge of the flash. So we're going to see some small dots of lightning. And that's why you want to position your starting point and end point close to each other. Now as for the settings of the lightning, put the segments to 3. Amplitude to 5, detail level to 1, width variation to 1/2, and core width to 1/2 as well. Now these settings will give you the most realistic results. Then for the colors, we've gone for a darker blue on the outside and a lighter variation on the inside. Finally, set the random seed to 100 and the blending mode to screen. And if that went a little bit too fast for you, here is the entire setting. You might want to pause the video right here if you are recreating this effect. Now create a mask inside the lightning effect itself. Now you can again pick the circle mask, change its size so that it sits just around the lightning. We're going to use this mask to animate the lightning dots coming in. Unfortunately, we don't have such a control within the lightning effect itself, so we'll have to do it this way. Now, from the beginning of the transparent video layer, change the mask expansion to a negative value until you don't see the spark anymore. Create a keyframe on that position and move a couple of frames forward. Here you increase the expansion until you do see the spark. Your first spark is complete! Now, luckily, we can copy this lightning effect a couple of times to make them appear on different locations. The only thing that you have to do is now reposition the start and end position of each spark and also its mask. You can duplicate this spark as much as you want, but usually you want to stay around 4 or 5 sparks. Now the sparks come in at different times, so offset the keyframes you have created for the mask expansion for each spark. Now you can let some keyframes start later or have the animation of another spark take longer. Just try to avoid that all the sparks come in at the same time. Alright, we've got a good looking spark, but we can make it look even better. The edges of the lightning looks pretty sharp, so we're going to soften that by adding a Gaussian blur to that clip. Add a little bit of blurriness to it, something around 3 or a maximum of 5 would do. Now we'll add some more background glow to those sparks. Duplicate the transparent video layer to the track below. Again, hold down your Alt key and drag it. It will duplicate everything we've just created. The blurriness in this duplication will be set to something around 150, which will act as the glow for the original spark. The final thing I'm going to do to the sparks is change the blending mode of the original layer, or the top layer. Set them to screen to blend them more natural with the scene. And that's how the sparks are created. And you might think, damn it, that's a lot of work. But that's just how visual effects work, and definitely if you're doing this inside Premiere. But it's just so much fun, isn't it, guys? Alright, let's now create those larger lightning effects. And it's pretty much the same as with the sparks, with just a few adjustments. You've already created a transparent video, so you can just take that one out of your projects panel and drag it to your timeline. It's going to be inserted next to the sparks. The start position and end position are now further from each other. You can let them start from the bottom and have the lighting go up. Here's a screenshot of the lightning settings. What we've changed is the segments to 14, the amplitude to 19, branching to 0.120, rebranching to 0, branch segment length to 1.2, branch segments to 6, branch width to 1/2, the speed to 2, width variation to 1/2, core width to 1/2, again those two blue colors, the random seed to 100, and finally the blending mode to screen. Again, you can pause the video here to check how your settings look. Now this lightning comes in immediately, but it fades out slowly. And this is why we'll animate the ending of the lightning. And this is after the flash has taken off. And since the lightning effect itself is so hard to animate, we'll create again a mask under the opacity of the layer. Click on the circle and enlarge the mask so that the lightning fits completely in it. Then create a keyframe for the mask path, just a couple of frames before the end of the clip. Move your keyframe to the end and change the path of the mask to the bottom. And this way, we've animated the lightning so that it seems like it's fading out. And this was for one lightning. Now simply duplicate the effect a couple of times. And just like with the sparks, you want to change the start and end point of every effect. Make it appear like it's all random. Some lightnings might come up higher than others. Finally, I'm going to add a Gaussian blur to it to take off those sharp edges again. Set it to around 3 or maximum 5. Now just like with the sparks, we'll also add some glow to these lightnings. Duplicate the layer to the track below. Now increase that Gaussian blur to 150. And this is the same technique as with the sparks. Alright, next up are the large light flashes you see right before the flash takes off. Now let's start with creating a color mat from the new item button in your project panel. You want to select a light blue color, something that matches with the colors of the sparks. Drag it to your timeline on top of the sparks. And this lighting is a flash, so make the clip about 2 frames long. Now you can already change the blending mode of this color mat to linear dodge, or add. Then head over to the effects library and search for lighting effects. Drag that to the color mat, and from its settings, we're going to change the light type to Omni. As for the radius, change that to around 12 and the intensity to 70. It might be that your clip needs some other radius or intensity value, but you can experiment with that. Now a flash suddenly pops in, and then it fades slowly out. So what we'll do is animate the opacity of that layer. Create a keyframe in the beginning of the clip at 100%. Move to the end of the clip and change the value to 0. Now when you select the lighting effects, you can also change the position of the light. Move it to wherever you want. Now we'll make sure that this flash appears several times, so we'll duplicate that layer a little further. Move the light source to a different position. You want to repeat this several times so that you see a stroke of flashes. If you like, you can also change the radius or intensity to have some more different flashes going on. And if everything went well, your flash takeoff should look something like this. Now, in the Justice League film, you would also see these sparks and smoke coming off from his lightning. Now, these are stock clips you could import and blend with your edits. And to make it accessible to everyone, we've actually recorded our own sparks so that we can share that with everyone for free. You can find a download link to it in the description below. Now, when you have this in your timeline, change its blending mode to Screen and change the opacity to 50. Then just position them where you want and perhaps add a few of these sparks. The same thing goes with the smoke. We didn't record this ourselves as it's not so easy as with the sparks, but luckily our sponsor Rocketstock came out with an awesome video pack called Vapor. It's a collection of more than 100 smoke clips, which you can bring in your edits the same way as with the sparks. Unfortunately, we cannot share a clip from it as it's a premium product, but it's definitely something I would recommend to check out. There are so many applications where you can use this, so make sure to visit that first link in the description below to find out more. And that was it for this tutorial. Your flash effect should look something like this now as the end result. I know it was a pretty long tutorial, but I do hope that you guys learned some new advanced techniques inside Premiere Pro. Thank you all so much for watching, and stay creative.
And flash!
The cup flash.
Meow!